close friends, family, or even the three people sitting next to you. Got them in mind? All right, with you and me, that's five people. According to the US CDC, one in five people in the US had a mental illness in 2022. That's one in five of us. Now, do you know how I know this for sure? Well, okay, this was a game I kind of rigged. I have anxiety. Not just the public speaking jitters kind, but the clinical kind that leads to worry and insomnia. In the United States, there's 57 million people with mental illness. That's 57 million people like me, and maybe you too. But unfortunately, long wait times, disparities in care, and poor access to providers leaves millions struggling in silence. What if there could be a different way to handle the mental health care crisis? What if there was a way to bridge the gap between accessible support and those who need the care that they well deserve? And what if artificial intelligence, or AI, was part of the solution? Artificial intelligence is poised to make a revolution in providing 24/7 accessible support to those who need it. We can work with, not alongside, of doctors and psychiatrists. Now, you might be thinking, isn't AI creepy and impersonal? It can be, because of the way that we build AI now. But there's a different way to build artificial intelligence, a person-centered approach that I pioneered in my research group. And this approach centers autonomy, ethics, and well-being at the core. And today I hope to show you what this vision for people-centered AI could be for mental health care. Building artificial intelligence is one of the most fulfilling parts of my job as a computer scientist and professor at the University of Minnesota. But I want to let you in on a secret that's changed the way that I think about building artificial intelligence. I'm a computer scientist and a social scientist too. Now, I've always been a nerd, don't worry. When I was seven, I used to beg to do problems from my mom's algebra textbooks for fun. No, seriously, when I was a little girl, my biggest dream was to be a computer engineer. But in middle and high school, I was the only girl in many of my math and coding classes. And my classmates sure liked to point that out a lot. And when I got to college, I dropped out of my computer science courses after the first class because I didn't want to feel isolated. But I couldn't stay away from computing. I just had to come at it in my own way, teaching myself with online computer science courses and moonlighting as a back-end web developer. And along the way, I got degrees in media studies and human-centered computing, which combines computer science with social science. Now, please don't worry, I still spend a lot of my days yelling at my computer because my code won't compile. But these experiences have shaped the way that I believe that technology should be built. I believe that artificial intelligence should be a human-first enterprise. What for fast and efficient algorithms if they don't help you make your collective lives better? I thought a lot about the ways that AI could support mental health care, like the fact that people don't get good access to providers. It takes an average of about 60 days for people to get care from the first time that they contact their provider and to the first intake appointment. Now, I'm sure you've heard about artificial intelligence. It's one of the most talked about innovations in the last decade, but sometimes it can sound like a mystery when it's coming from a news report. At its core, AI takes in data as input, produces a model, and as output, produces a bunch of kinds of responses. Now, as input, AI can take in data beyond the scale of what humans can understand, like all of Wikipedia. And artificial intelligence builds a model from that data. But what makes AI so special and what makes it intelligent is that it's not a long list of rules. AI models are able to understand what the rules should be without humans telling them what it needs. And as output, AI can produce lots of kinds of outputs, like drafting emails or helping identify friends in your personal photo galleries. Now, I've thought a lot about how AI can help with mental health, like the fact that many people don't ever seek treatment for their mental health. You remember that statistic about one in five Americans who struggle with mental illness? Only about half of those people will receive treatment for their mental illness in a given year. And the average delay between symptom onset and first treatment for mental illness is 11 years, right? 11 years. Now, there's lots of reasons why people don't seek treatment for their mental health. Sure, cost and accessibility come into play, but many people go at it alone, thinking that it's not that big of a deal. And when they realize that something's wrong, well, they don't ask for help. When my anxiety was coming up during college and in my teen years, I didn't realize it was normal for people to stay up until 3 or 4 a.m. And when I noticed that my college classmates could go to sleep after pulling an all-nighter and I couldn't for weeks on end, I was embarrassed, and finding a therapist took forever. My story is one symptom of a larger issue with wait times and providers in the United States. Even if we could funnel every single dollar we have for healthcare to mental health, we just don't have enough providers to see the people who need it. And the average adult waits about 60 days from the first time that they contact a provider to their first intake appointment. Imagine waiting 60 days to see someone because of strep throat. How could AI help in this circumstance? Well, AI can't replace your therapist, but it can provide support until help arrives. Scientists like me and my group are using AI to identify tiny changes in the ways that you engage with your technology that may indicate that something is going wrong. We're able to use cues that are pretty obvious, like the fact that you might start scrolling on your phone until 3 or 4 a.m. But we're also able to use subtle cues too, like the fact that you might start changing the way you speak to friends in online conversations. Now, if you're thinking about ethics right now, I can see a couple of you furrowing your brows. Hold that thought. I promise I'm about to come back to it. Let's take a couple of examples of research from my research group. So in one study, we were able to use 26 million public Instagram posts to know if your mental health was changing based on the text underneath the photos. And in another follow-up study, we were able to use the images on those posts with the captions itself to get a holistic view about the content that people were posting and what it said about their well-being. And it's not just on Instagram or with photos that we can do this. We're building culturally adaptive AI for depression detection, and also building AI that can provide support to people helping others through mental health crises. And it's not just me and my research group either. There are scientists who are working on research to build AI for postpartum depression detection and schizophrenia too. We're now entering an era where we can use this AI to build interventions, to operate 24/7 to know when our loved ones need support. Imagine AI being there for our friends and family when we couldn't or didn't even know that they needed help. Social media companies are already starting to build this AI behind the scenes. And in one case, a company deployed an AI to predict suicide crisis. They said after a year of deployment that 3,500 people were identified by this AI system. But what's cool is that these 3,500 people were identified that weren't already reported to the platform by friends and family. That's 3,500 new opportunities to save somebody's life. This sounds amazing, right, and transformative. Let's unpin that ethics discussion, because building AI gets tricky for mental health, and I want to talk about the downsides. AI models are new technology, and they can break and say the wrong things, things that can be downright insincere and harmful. People have manipulated chatbots to give dangerous advice to people with eating disorders and who are thinking of self-injury. Moreover, misidentification of mental illness can have serious downstream consequences. Should AI agents automatically intervene with friends and family when they believe that somebody's in crisis? Should AI send the police? What about when AI misses someone? Who is responsible? Right now, we have little say over these AI systems, how they're built and deployed. These are built by tech companies that often don't have our best interests at heart. Take one example of a company that provides peer support for mental health. They replaced human conversations with AI-generated ones and didn't tell anybody they did it until after they did it to 4,000 people. And in another example, this one really, really bothers me, a nonprofit support line that provides crisis support for people in suicide crisis wanted to sell its data to an AI startup. Now, this is conversations of people in their most dire mental health moments. And what is the purpose of the AI startup? To build e-commerce chatbots. Yeah, I hear a couple of groans and you're probably bristling, right? You're thinking, Stevie, crisis conversations shouldn't be used to build AI to sell shoes. Why would you want AI to replace your therapist? To be honest, I don't. I don't want AI to replace my therapist or your providers, nor do I want it to take advantage of people. This is where my experience outside of computer science and social science come into play. We need to protect the most sacred parts of ourselves, our mental well-being, from the harms of AI. That's why we need a radically different approach to building AI, a person-centered approach. This isn't about creating robotic replacements for human connection that exploit you and your data. This is about building nuanced systems that can understand mental health, provide tailored and timely support to people, and do so ethically. How will we do that? Here's three things that we can do now. The first thing that we need to do is ask people what they want AI to do for them and build that. Most AI is built by tech companies who often don't ask people what they want their AI systems to do. This is crucial when it comes to mental health care. Now, my research group at the University of Minnesota has talked to about 50 people about this question in the last year alone. And our participants in my studies have wonderful ideas on ways to build AI to be more people-centered. For example, one of our participants gave this wonderful idea of a choose-your-own-adventure book. Instead of the AI picking the prediction and choosing the next page to advance the plot, you would be put in the driver's seat to choose whether or not you would be connected with supportive friends or perhaps stopping scrolling online. Second, we need to make sure that people have control over the results of the AI systems or have the ability to opt out entirely. AI often makes a guess, often with no feedback from the user about whether or not it was the right or correct thing to do. Moments of agency are crucial to build into AI systems to make sure that people have much deserved respect and autonomy. For example, our participants wanted to correct AI when it got the answers wrong. But frankly, our participants also wanted to tell AI systems when they were struggling, so AI could work better for their specific circumstances. And some of our participants wanted to opt out of AI entirely. Let's not make AI so paternalistic that we take away people's rights to choose to participate in these new technological systems. Third, we need to collaborate with doctors, social workers, and policymakers to get the nuances of AI right. Doctors and social workers bring their real-world experience, and their expertise is vital in guiding the development of AI that can respond to the diverse needs of individuals. And we need to work with policymakers to get the ethical and legal frameworks of AI and mental health care right. Their expertise is vital in making sure that engineers aren't the only ones that decide how and when we deploy AI systems. Imagine a world where, through the devices in our hands, AI can become a compassionate ally for mental health. It can offer tailored and timely support and human connection when we may not even realize it ourselves. But this world will not happen unless we fundamentally change the way that we make AI, to make people-centered AI that puts autonomy, ethics, and empathy in the center of every single design. Let's make sure that we weave empathy and ethics into every line of code, and that those 1 in 5 will never be alone. Thank you.